Mula-mula ingat ni just a comedy yang boleh lupakan macam tu, tapi tak sangka ada depth. And I was really surprised, so much so that I started reading it.
I have to say the mangaka is very innovative. Dia bukan saja faham D&D, dungeon crawling and dungeon mastering, tapi dia juga faham the fantasy tropes, and then disadurkan dengan an element of MasterChef. So aku macam, this is the coolest shit I've ever seen. And it's so weird. It is so weird. But at the same time, as we get deeper into the seasons, where the dungeon punya storyline, the master of the dungeon, the different king. So aku macam, that's what 13-year-old me love. So it's like a mixture of so many things.
Yeah.
So that's why I love Dungeon Meshi. Baik.
That's thick. Nice one.
I'm going to say Dungeon Meshi is very deep, actually. Just because you think it's like this, it becomes something else, deeper and better and more serious. It's overwhelming at times, but it's not frustrating. It keeps surprising you in good ways.
Appreciate cerita ni sebab dia macam the focus dekat survival, focus dekat food appreciation, even zoology. And I like the way they play around with the different like races and all that, you know, including the concept of tall man and everything like that. Rasa lah macam what you call that thing, untuk cerita yang fantasy dan the applykan the concept of from games in this, including macam revive and everything, the way they do it is very intelligent and they have in-universe reasons for them to happen instead of just like, oh, because no games does this, so in our world it just applies itself like that. There's no reason for it.
Quite surprising that you think that no other adventurers thought about that. Sanggup bila makanan habis berlapar semua sampai mati semua bagai.
But actually, I'm reminded of Diablo bila kau the scroll of town portal, you know, when your mana is low and shit.
Okay.
And you're so kau guna scroll of town portal, whatever level you're on, you scroll of town portal back to town, and then you sell all your shit, and then you buy food, you get your mana bottles back up. So this is way more realistic to me, where there is no scroll of town portal, especially when you lost Falin, you lost your main magician. So This is the way.
Yeah. Actually, macam funny that you mentioned Doom because sorry, what was it? The game that you mentioned?
Diablo. Back in the
Diablo. Game. Sorry. Yeah. Okay. Uncle sini main korang cukup gelaknya. Tata gue have to look up Wikipedia. There used to be a company called Origin, series called Ultima. And when I started playing, it was Ultima 3. You can in modern day, you can go on the net and play obviously with modern processors. They really need to slow it down. Ni zaman-zaman komputer yang ada berapa kilobyte je as dia punya memory. You can imagine lah. So as a fan of Lord of the Rings, and then I used to read my brother's Lone Wolf book, and then playing Ultima, you understood the concept of having a party made of different jobs. And then, and of course, bila tengok-tengok macam ni, it was really familiar to me. And like you said, like when you lose Falin, like, she was a bit of both, wasn't she? I mean, she was more of a white magician, I guess.
I think she's a paladin, good. She's more like a paladin kind of magician. Like, not really.
I think she's a cleric, actually.
Ah, cleric. Yeah, sorry, my bad. Cleric, yeah.
Because compared
because
to
Marshall. She's a one miss, something like that.
Yeah. Okay. Sorry. Aku termelalut sikit tadi because I was actually wanting to talk about food. So, the reason being, in my short experience, memang zaman dulu memang kena macam beli makanan banyak-banyak. So I'm probably the viewer that would have behaved like the other adventurers. And unlike Lewis Toden who would have like, hey, we're going to eat monsters, save duit. You know, apa pendapat anda? I will start off with Nick. When you watch this, did you think that the fact that tiap jodol untuk anime ini, semuanya nama makanan, adakah ini antara sebab yang buat anda macam tak sangka cerita ni is more than just bloody eating in the dungeon?
Basically, everything that they eat on the day.
Yeah. So yeah. Kalau kau tengok title and you join late, kau macam, alah, dia orang nak tunjuk dia masak ni.
I think the first one starts with the walking mushroom, kan?
Yeah.
The walking mushroom was tasty, man. Aku macam, macam menarik tu. But I think it's a very quirky angle yang buat kau tertarik. Because you don't know if it's going to be an action episode or an episode where dia orang resting or an episode where they are in danger. So it's very, very cool. And dia, at the same time, dia buat kau fikir macam mana dia nak makan living armor? Macam mana dia orang nak makan chimera? What would the chimera taste like? So it tugs at your brain and what kau fikir, not really where the plot is going, but what it's going to taste like. So I find it quite good. I find it quite critical that way. I feel like for D&D players, a total party kill, a TPK, is very normal. So starting episode 1 with a TPK is like memang benda paling basic yang most D&D players experience on a weekly basis anyway. So that was a very nice gateway reason to start. And then it gave them the motivation of like, kita dah tak ada duit. Two our team members decided to leave the team after the TPK. So it gave them the motivation. They needed to save Falin. It gave them a timeline. We need to save them within the next, I don't know, the next 7 days before they kena telan dengan dragon tu. And then I think meeting Senshi was the right time, right place kind of thing.
Yeah.
It became like their guide, like their Obi-Wan leading into their adventure.
Yeah.
So, the TPK was the genesis of this whole, we need to get there within X number of time, and then Senshi was just there to give them a different experience. Aku rasa they were saying that, oh, kita dah sampai level 4 so fast pasal thanks to Senshi, and then kita jumpa Ox. Soalnya kita gaduh dengan Ox, tapi Senshi was integral. So, it's nice to see them adventuring with Senshi and how it's different from when they were with that samurai guy, when they were with that woman dwarf.
So,
I love the TPK aspect of the series. So,
I'm glad that you mentioned things like that. So, we're going to appoint you the Dungeons and Dragons / gaming aspect of this discussion, which is why one reason why, as much as why cerita ni dah habis, tapi macam, you know, I want to have a nice angle to it. To be talking about it, and obviously what you just said is pretty much also leading to the question I'm going to ask Andre as well. It was interesting, and as what Sai was saying, how they need to go back to get the dragon. For those who've played games like this before, you would know that anything big like that red dragon or as powerful as that dragon is going to be like a bit deep down in the dungeons. So, you know, bila kita masuk dungeon, selalunya tingkat satu yang poyo-poyo macam obviously that you get those walking mushroom, kan? Sekali tumbuk mati. Kan? So, but to think that they need to make haste in a way, because if Lyra was confident that they could get back before she get digested, I mean, he had a few things in his mind. He was thinking, kalau dragon ni selalu tidur, dia kata. So, dia sure lambat digestnya. So, obviously, we're going to get to this
later. Yeah, I think I need to raise a point here. In the first episode, kan, where the whole party was got wiped out, right? It was because they met the red dragon under the worst circumstances ever. They were hungry. And second of all, they were not ready. They didn't expect to meet with a red dragon on that level, though. So they got wiped out. They weren't ready. It's like you got up from the lift, and then a swarm of zombies kind of come. From both sides, you're screwed because you don't even get into position or of hiring position or whatever it is you have need to do lah. But that's how the first episode started. They were overwhelmed by the red dragon. Okay, so they were there to fight the dragon.
Yeah. So the question I was going to ask you anyway. I mean, by the time when they were going to the, I can't remember which level, but it was in which they discovered the lifeless bodies of this party led by Kabru, the person in the armor. Ingat kan dia ni party dia ada anjing semua. Level 3. Tapi it was at the time that you think that if Lauer's punya party had gone down.
You see this picture, Kabru? Don't tell me he doesn't look like very feminine, like a male Kaska from Berserk. just waiting. Sorry. He goes to level 4 and gets raped by Griffin again.
Yeah, so you could tell that his party is really inexperienced. I mean, obviously, in the subsequent episode, when they got screwed again, within 2 episodes or within 2 levels, I mean, laughing at that. But Laios party, I mean, they were strong by the time they got to see meet the red dragon. But it was then realized they have had undergone kills or death. I mean, can the obviously Marcel, not Marcel, what's the name, Fallon would have revived.
I think Kabu first then. they kena the treasure, right? The living treasure.
Yeah,
mula kena the living treasure, lepas tu kau kena dengan fishman. Gila, lemah sia.
I agree with that. I think Kabru's group is very naive, the whole bunch of them. Kabru for me, they're very idealistic. Because he's got his own agenda, which we will talk about why he's doing what he's doing. And then, aku personally tak suka dia. I finished the manga. I can safely say, aku still tak suka dia. Regardless what happened in the end.
I'm just saying, I like him, but the problem is, he feels like he's in the wrong anime. It feels like it's the main character of another anime inside, right? An intelligent anime. It feels like that. But I really do enjoy like him, especially on episode 17 and everything like that. I don't know, man. I just like his straightforwardness, but at the same time, he's willing to give everyone a chance. But he's naive in the broad sense. But in terms of his perception, while he is like unlocked in some kind of thought, his train of thought is very sharp, and he keeps his defense up, so people can't read him while he read the environment. It's just that how he thinks doesn't apply to that dungeon, and it doesn't apply to this anime. It's like applies to any other anime. It's like the most intelligent main character there is just in the wrong anime.
Aku mula start lambat actually. I think I started bila dah midway through the season, pasal aku nampak dekat TikTok this D&D guy that I follow, Dungeons & Dragons. Dia kata, this is the coolest implementation of dungeon mastering I have ever seen, where I think Senshi put the holy water in a glass jar and then he made it like a swing macam tu. And then bila dia terkena ghost macam, okay, I gotta charge. Selalunya bila kau guna holy water, kau simbah dekat benda tu.
Yeah, but when dekat ghost kan.
Glass jar, and then it goes to the ghost. Aku tak pernah terfikir siapa. Yeah. Dia macam ni, what is this
and
show?
He makes sorbet. Pada anda yang pernah makan sorbet. Sorbet ni macam
sorbet.
Ah, sorbet tau. Terus.
Extreme.
Yeah, that was
Allah. Nampak sedap sial.
The ghost that ghost episode turned into TikTok video, and then also the living armor turned into TikTok video. So after watching those two videos, I had to watch the show. So
you had to watch
actually
it
was on Netflix, and then I just marathoned it in like days.
Yeah.
I have a confession to make. When they were
episode
yang living armor tu kan, I can actually imagine and taste the kerang of that dish tau. Yeah, I can taste
crap
in my mouth when I watched that.
Yeah, man. It was so graphic, man. The cooking was like, wow.
Oh,
man.
God, man. Oh, it looks so good.
Yeah, yeah.
Good point.
Tapi another thing as well, another thing they tackled about in this series, which I find quite not refreshing, but jenis macam, it's not for the sake of just makan monster, benda disgusting or sebenarnya sedap. But I like how the author, remember when they went to the bit where the part of the castle was submerged, where the mermen and mermaids were, and then she encountered this creature which she had encountered before, the seahorse. What was it? Kelpie.
Is it called like,
the bit that you kind of, the lesson that was taught to the party that then the monsters are monsters regardless lah, dia tunjuk affection towards kau dia ke apa
betul ini? Sebenarnya dia bukan jinak.
Dia nak makan kau.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because unfortunately I was spoiled slightly before that. I ternampak something on biasalah Twitter kan, and then dia kata what the impression it gave me that somebody had to kill a pet or something, but it wasn't. But now seeing the contract, but yeah, but it was, yeah. Regardless, Sensi still like took care, and you know, dia kata give me the carcass, I'll clean it, and as you would lah, macam benda yang kau sayang kau sembelih betul-betul.
And then I love that episode where Marcel kata kita tak boleh makan fishman pasal dia humanoid. Benda humanoid, benda lain boleh makan, tapi once it's a humanoid, kita tak boleh makan. Lepas tu, Lion macam
mistis. And then the fact that the sea kelp, dia telur merman.
Dia buat nasi. Dia kata, we didn't eat any. Did we?
Yang dryad punya tu. Yang macam pumpkin tu kan.
Pumpkin, dia ada muka.
Yeah, the dryads, man.
That's so disturbing, but at the same time, aku memang suka labu kan, so macam leleh elu aku.
Another funny thing that I found really funny was the golem.
Awesome. GM awesome. Mana fikir benda ni fucking awesome sial.
This is kebun.
Since you mentioned that, what are golems? I mean, so the golems, man. The golems in Final Fantasy, they were like creatures, similar creatures, but for me they were rocks. Humanoid rocks, and they were big, and not very good. I'm not talking about gargoyles. I'm just talking about humanoid rocks with dome heads. I mean, what's the context of golems within Dungeons & Dragons? Are they like made of earth? Like,
effectively they are made of earth, and they go through the levels of the dungeon. So it was so cool because they were so deep in the dungeon, yang diorang dah tak ada fresh vegetables. So the fact that they ada kebun on the back of the golem, aku macam
tanah je kan.
Ada sunlight like untuk the vegetables grow tu.
They are like made out of tanah kan. Ada dan batu,
tanah,
ada
dan, tanah, ada yang ais. Tanah dan manusia, the elf.
Yes.
Yeah. Sensi was a tukar.
Baja.
Kelakar, memang kelakar gila.
Oh god.
Have you played Neverwinter Nights?
Not me, anybody else?
Tak pernah main. Okay, in the RPG, right, every town, every city is ruled by a lord, and he's basically the king of the city lah. And despite dia punya rank kan, even though they share loyalty to the king, right, they did what as they please and they hide stuff. So the lord of this particular city, right, dungeon, right, we see him as this inept lord. Dia macam tak nak masuk campur about what's going to happen in the dungeon. Sanggup sampai serah kuasa dekat apa the elf, as long as he gets compensation or tribute, whatever it is lah. This is the basically the mindset of every lord in every D&D game in Neverwinter Nights, Baldur's Gate. You see the D&D film, right? It's like that. They just worried about themselves. So they're not actually intertwined. They intertwine when it's convenient. Most of the time, they just separate from other settlements. That's why Kapu, right, when something happens to the town village, right, no one came to help. The elves came to crisis control. Okay, they were not there to help anyone. The fact that he got rescued by this one elven soldier yang that was mentioned, it's just by luck, by chance. They were not there to help him. For all they know, there were no survivors. So if you're going to say it's all intertwined, maybe, but most of the time they just cut themselves off from each other settlements, mostly worried about their own punya perut lah. So you have to remember, he was rescued and raised by the elves, one of the most trusted races in that particular universe now. The dwarf, the gnome, the humans, tak percaya elf. Even the orcs kan, they hate elves. But everyone, in most RPG settings, right, the elves are like a wise, noble race. But
Lord here, rings.
Right, see them, have their own agenda.
Yeah.
And it's really apparent. Yeah,
this is the first time I hated them. The only elf I liked was Marcel.
they are the oldest race and they seem to know how to rule better. So dia macam
yeah, rule better.
Korang Tolman ni korang tak apa tahu. Korang hidup berapa tahun je. So yeah, they quite douchebags lah. They really douchebags lah.
And the only reason Marcel kan is likable kan is because she is not raised by with the other elves.
Dia half kan? Dia half elf.
Yeah, memang nampak ah macam karakter Kabru tu memang he's cunning like an elf. And then apa tu yang no Marcel tu is like loving and and caring like a human. Aku rasa macam it is like in a way both is part for the cause untuk cerita ni ada explanation for the dungeons everything. But at the same time, this is when I say this like anime is intelligent. If it's any other anime, including one of the more popular ones, like is it okay to pick up girls in dungeon or whatever?
Yeah.
And then Overlord. It's like, okay, why is there a dungeon? Because it's like a game, so there's a dungeon and they just leave it there. So they take a step further to create this law surrounding it, connecting everything together. There's even an explanation why people are to be revived, because their soul is bound to the dungeon. So when you die outside of the dungeon, you straight up die. But if you're in the dungeon, you're bound to it. But only if you're a living being. If you're like a monster or you're anything else, you just die, right? So I just love the fact that they go the extra mile to actually connect everything together, and there's a reasoning behind every single thing. So it feels like everybody is like a cog in the bigger machine, right?
I really enjoy this series because it's very immersive. Immersive as in whatever they do, right? We can actually relate to it. We can feel it for some reason. We are attached to it. And it's very unforgiving. Unforgiving as in the enemy is no joke. Well, I'm not talking about the mad magician. I'm talking about the dragon. The first episode, kan, you just met him and you just walked out your party. And then you find out and you hunt him and you lost a limb or two. And you barely survive battle. So it's not a happy adventure. I really appreciate that. A lot of the Japanese punya RPG fantasy setting kan, you get a hero that have apa macam a special skill or special magic, or you know, he's a good fighter, very fast or something like that. But no, these guys, Laios semua ni kan, they use more of cunning and tactics lah, okay? They know they outpower him, they cannot outrun this guy. They can just put some plans into action and hopefully it works. And most of the time it doesn't work, so they have to improvise. So I appreciate how unforgiving this thing is. It's like playing XCOM, where every time you make a mistake, you pay with your character death, and then you have to do better next time. This is what it is.
Yeah, definitely.
Dia boleh you boleh ulang balik ke, atau you have to get on with the game?
Yeah, Iron Man tak boleh ulang balik. There's a setting called Iron Man for the game where you cannot reload your game.
No saves lah. No saves.
クリティカルヒット。これで倒せそう。敵を撃破しました。護衛は成功です。テーブルトークRPGすっかりキャラになりきっちゃったよ。さて、次の冒険に進もうか。この格好どうした？かっこいい。世界で一番遊ばれている TRPG
ダンジョンズ&ドラゴンズ。 I think this mangaka is a D&D player, and maybe he is a game master for his own group of friends.
It'll be quite interesting because I have no idea. It's a she, Nick.
Oh, it's a she.
Yeah. Ryoko.
She's a fan of the fantasy genre. She plays D&D. She plays all those apa yang those books kan, yang RPG.
Yeah, right, fantasy books.
Apa? Lone Wolf. Kawan Shaz.
The somersault, yeah. Whatever it is, yeah. But the main inspiration for this anime, right, was a video game. Yang lama yang dia main tau. I'm not sure what it's called lah, but I think you've heard of the story lah.
Yeah, the way she thinks and the way she writes is a person that is very in-depth punya thinking. Because when you play D&D, you're always trying to outsmart the game master. So all the way she sets this up is memang game master level tinggi lah. Aku respect. Mm.
Okay, I'll say just a quick one. Rokyo Kui, she's dia ni rahsia, tak nak beritahu umur dia berapa tahun. Thus far, I can find in flipping Wikipedia, they describe, I just want to see her style. Noted for portrayal of reality and fantasy with her unique point of view. Obviously, it sounds like a translation from Japanese news portals or something, so doesn't really explain anything. Writing for comic Natalie, embodying unnaturalness, noted in an interview. She has an affinity with dragons and has had dragons featured in several works. Ah, right. She's read The Neverending Story, Lord of the Rings, as well as researching rule books of Dungeons and Dragons after having it seen arise several times for her research prior to the manga serialization. She's a noted fan of computer role-playing games and previously drawn fan art for Baldur's Gate 1, 2, 3... Pathfinder, Planetscape. As a child, she observed her father play Wizardry on the Famicom, as well as Dragon Quest Ultima. Yay, Ultima!
That's the game, yeah.
Yeah, Fire Emblem. So, she also cited Wizardry 4. 6, sorry. Tapi yang Dungeon Dragon, interestingly, dia baca rulebook je. Dia tak pernah main. Tapi,
well, actually, to be a game master, you need to know the rulebook,
yeah?
Yeah, so that's why she thinks like a game master, because she
learned
all the rules, how to build a level, how to build a monster, what are their stats, how to beat them. So, they ada fire damage ke, ataupun dia ada water damage. So, yeah, she understands the meta.
Dungeons and Dragons, dia memang dungeons kan? You not go to the surface to travel somewhere else. It's not like Lord of the Rings.
They are... You start in a tavern, and then from a tavern in the town, you go down into the dungeons.
Basically,
macam Diablo. Effectively,
kau tak Diablo. Ada, kau tak ada macam jalan like 40 kilometers first to get to the dungeon. Tak ada lah. Macam, macam Final Fantasy.
There are multiple towns, and some towns are so popular, like it has its own guilds and shit like that. Macam
so, do you have to go back up every time you need to replenish?
I think some games you don't even go into a dungeon. Some games you're just in the city, and then the city has enough intrigue.
The whole universe kan revolves on the Wizards of the Coast now. So there are a lot of cities involved. Neverwinter, Baldur's Gate, that city at South 50, I keep forgetting name. Also notorious, ruled by four wizards something like that. It's very vast. Universe lah. So you do play in dungeons, but also play in
Waterdeep. I fucking love
Waterdeep. Yeah, yeah.
The town of Waterdeep with its guilds of thieves and adventurers. Yeah, Waterdeep is one of the more where you don't go into the dungeon. You're just in Waterdeep, the port town, and then Waterdeep has so many guilds and kau bergaduh antara guilds.
Districts and what? But you travel. Yeah,
Aku ada lagi satu soalan menyimpang again to Nick and anybody who play D&D. So basically in D&D, how do you resurrect your party members, or you don't?
Certain clerics can do that. That's why total party kill is part of the game, where korang semua dah mati, and then
so that you can end the game.
The cleric will do the resurrection spell so that you guys can restart your adventure.
Unless the cleric dies as well lah in the TPK.
Yes, selalunya is the job of like the team leader. Macam okay guys, make sure cleric tolong buat shield ataupun resurrection spell sedia, stuff like
I mean macam uncle punya Ultima, I can't remember what the name of the spell for resurrect. I think it's just called resurrect. For Final Fantasy players, obviously you know what Phoenix Downs are, so you use Phoenix Downs to resurrect your characters. And then but obviously, in Dungeon Meshi, dia menambahkan konsep yang the fact that the soul, what if you die in the, it's easier for you to come back to life. Kau soul kau tak pergi tempat lain, which is interesting because kau perasan kan ada yang team Kabru yang mati 3-4 kali tu because kena con, because there's a bunch of people who actually resurrect people for money.
Man, you patut sial. Boleh jadi side business pula. Memang macam pukimak sial. Macam sial dia. It's like oh, banyak sangat dungeon crawlers. We will make a business of resurrecting dungeon crawlers. Macam what the fuck sial.
Itulah.
And then business is slow. If business is slow, we just gonna kill them. And then we ask them, okay,
we do it again.
The value go up. Macam the deeper they go in the dungeon, the more people, the more monsters they kill. So when they do die, to revive them or something, did their value go up or something? So like, is there a economy value like that? Of the dead?
I think it's harder for the resurrectors to go down to level 6. So maybe they're going to charge you more like, eh, cibai, kau mati level 3 boleh lah. Senang, aku ada 10 group mati. Tapi ni, aku nak kena go all the way down. It took me a week, so I'm going to charge you more. Maybe lah.
Ada.